old axiom, there's no business like show business, is trite but true. In the early morning hours, the show began. Arriving at Weircook Municipal Airport, the Beatles got their first view of Indiana. The fans, few in number, were shocked that the moment had really arrived. There were the anticipated screams and squeals as the fans caught their first glimpse of the quartet. The security precautions, far more elaborate than when the late President Kennedy visited the same airport, included landing the plane at a little-used section of the field and surrounding it with 60 policemen. Born in Liverpool, England, a town referred to by some cynics as the Brooklyn of Britain, among people described as fun-minded and earthy, the Beatles have become used to the crowd. They know its power. They're dependent upon its applause. Tomorrow there will be 26,000 at the Indiana State Fair waiting to see them perform. Tomorrow the crowd would grow in size, becoming capable of any emotion. Now, however, things were proceeding according to a carefully plotted master plan conceived months in advance. The dull monotony of constantly getting off and on airplanes in a strange country often confuses George, Paul, John, and Ringo. Sometimes it's difficult for them to determine exactly where they are. Once the cameras begin to grind and the many flashbulbs begin to pop, the Beatles are at home. These are the sounds they know and understand. The Beatles, famous for the Mersey sound, stopped in Indianapolis in the midst of a 33-day tour of 23 American cities. The entire tour is expected to gross $2 million. For the two shows at the Indiana State Fair, they were to receive $100,000. And then it was time to leave. The policemen, taking a deep breath of fresh air, prepared themselves for the hours and minutes yet to come. In the morning, the remarkably well-kept secret began to leak out. People whispered that the Beatles were housed at the Speedway Motel. The screaming, violent crowds of people were still not in evidence. A few faithful fans maintained a vigil outside the police lines in hopes of getting a glimpse of just one Beatle. The policeman, ready for any emergency, waited.
To me, last night's performance, from the audience standpoint, was the worst because it was the most hysterical crowd I've seen since you started your tour, San Francisco, Las Vegas included. Do you agree with that point of view?
Not really. I didn't think at the time of our show it was the most hysterical. But I thought after the show, more things happened than at the other places. Like, we couldn't get out for a start. Everything seemed to go wrong. But apart from that, I didn't think it was the most hysterical crowd because I think mainly they had the house lights up on in the Coliseum, whatever it was.
On behalf of all of the State Fair Board and all the good guys from WIFE, may I present the Beatles!
you, folks. The next...
She loves you, yeah, yeah, yeah. She loves you, yeah, 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 yeah. You think you've lost your love? Well, I saw her yesterday, yeah. You, and you know you should be glad. She said you hurt her so, she almost lost her mind. Now she says you know you're not the hurting kind. She said she loves you, and you know that can be bad. She loves you, and you know you should be glad. You know you should be glad. You know it's up to you. I think it's only fair. I can hurt you too. Apologize to her. Because she loves you. You know that can be bad. She loves you. And you know you should be glad. Understand when I do that something, I wanna hold your hand.
I've been in love before, and I found that love was more than just holding hands. If I get
sing a song which was also off our first Capitol album. So now, if he's ready.
If the mic's on.
Yes, he is. Singing a song.
One, two, three, four.
Singing a song called Boys Ringo. Thank you, Ringo.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, Ringo. The next song we're going to do is our latest record over here in England, and it's the title song from the film we just made. It's called A Hard Day's Night.
It's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a duck. It's been a hard day's night. I should be sleeping like a nut. But when I get home to you, I find a thing.
Beatles, escaping the 13,000 fans who attended the first performance, were whisked to another building for a press conference before the second show. As the last screams faded away, even the critics remarked how well the teenagers behaved during the performance. It was true that many girls wept. It was true that many were hoarse from their incessant screaming. The casualties, however, were light. The potential danger of that many people all together at one time was great. The Beatles, fresh despite their exhausting ordeal, were still able to fascinate those who were willing to watch. Their accents were fab. Their dialogue was fantastic. Outside, along the midway of the State Fair, teenage boys were buying I Hate the Beatles buttons. As the Beatles prepared to vacate their 12 rooms and move to another city and another performance, there were still those willing to watch and look. Some were curious, some were bored, and many were infatuated. They'd come to see something, anything. The switchboard operators at the Speedway Motel were still busy with... The old axiom, there's no business like show business, is trite but true. In the early morning hours, the show began. Arriving at Weircook Municipal Airport, the Beatles got their first view of Indiana. The fans, few in number, were shocked that the moment had really arrived. There were the anticipated screams and squeals as the fans caught their first glimpse of the quartet. The security precautions, far more elaborate than when the late President Kennedy visited the same airport, included landing the plane at a little-used section of the field and surrounding it with 60 policemen. Born in Liverpool, England, a town referred to by some cynics as the Brooklyn of Britain, among people described as fun-minded and earthy, the Beatles have become used to the crowd. They know its power. They're dependent upon its applause. Tomorrow there will be 26,000 at the Indiana State Fair waiting to see them perform. Tomorrow the crowd would grow in size, becoming capable of any emotion. Now, however, things were proceeding according to a carefully plotted master plan conceived months in advance. The dull monotony of constantly getting off and on airplanes in a strange country often confuses George, Paul, John, and Ringo. Sometimes it's difficult for them to determine exactly where they are. Once the cameras begin to grind and the many flashbulbs begin to pop, the Beatles are at home.